Good evening. Good evening, welcome. So my name is Peter Coleman, and I am on faculty here at Columbia, and I am a co-founder of this consortium, AC4, which is the Advanced Consortium on Cooperation, Conflict, and Complexity, which is at the Earth Institute here at Columbia University. I co-founded it with Beth Yoshida Fisher, who is somewhere here, there. And Josh Fisher is the current director of it. And I just want to first thank all of the extraordinary staff of AC4 and all and NECR and the Conflict Resolution Center at TC who've helped with this event. Thank you very much, and please give them a thank you for organizing this. And this is our fourth annual conference on sustaining peace, and the theme tonight is A New Vision of Women, Peace, and Security. Let me just say a couple things about AC4. This consortium started in 1997 when a group of young, foolish, untenured, low-power faculty at Columbia looked around and realized that there were people across the university at almost every school doing work on peace, on violence reduction, on conflict resolution, and yet we had no knowledge of each other. Columbia's a very siloed place. You work in your little cubicle and you don't reach out that often. And so we started to look around and try to gather a network, which the university supported initially in 97. And then we launched this consortium of scholars and practitioners, faculty and students at Columbia in 2009, is that right? And today there are over 200 faculty and about 50 centers and institutes across the university that are affiliated with AC4, which is this consortium. So AC4 is a hub. It's just a space that connects the dots of many of you and many people that aren't here who are doing good work on peace and conflict at the university. We support research, particularly the fellows. So in the foyer, you may have noticed that there are posters of this year's fellows. There's also a new group of fellows that I think is being announced tonight. And these are people from all over the university as well, doing master's and PhDs and working in the area of peace all over the world in these extraordinary projects. So you'll have a chance, if you didn't, afterwards, there'll be a reception outside to see some of the work of the current fellows. And we also sponsor events like this. So we've done this for 4 years. Leymah, I think, was our first speaker in our first year. Tonight we'll have a keynote presentation, which I'll introduce our speaker in a second. And then there will be a panel of discussants, two discussants that will be moderated by Beth, and a chance for a Q&A after that. And then we'll break outside, go outside and have some wine and cheese and mingle in a reception afterwards. So that's the structure of the evening. But just to frame it a little bit, again, the focus of tonight is the importance of women, the critical importance of women in the role they play in fostering peace and engendering security around the world. Our colleague Jean-Marie Guénot, who is the current president of the International Crisis Group, who was the head of the Center for International Conflict Resolution here for a couple of years, has been speaking recently about an emerging crisis that the international community is not well prepared to manage. And he's arguing that what's happening in his purview from the head of the International Crisis Group in watching trends is that the world is moving from one of bilateralism and hegemony to one of multilateralism to what he calls a crisis of complexity, where we have many non-state actors and hackers and social entrepreneurs and NGOs, and these groups are growing exponentially and having more and more and more impact on the political processes. And so in many ways, it's a crisis for the international community because they are not organized to understand, relate, and work in that context. They're used to working in a more orderly and more simplified context. The good news for peace is that the shift really opens up opportunities for many extraordinary groups that have been marginalized in the past to be involved in around involvement in peace to become more directly involved. So in this book, which we put out a couple of years ago on the psychological components of sustainable peace, Leymah Gbowee and Abby Disney authored a chapter on gender and sustainable peace. And they began it by saying The Cold War saw the collapse of nations and the rapid emergence of deadly civil wars. Communities were shattered, and the norms and values that held the fabric of these communities together discarded. From Bosnia to Serbia, Somalia to Rwanda, Liberia to Sierra Leone, the stories were the same: mass murders and rape of women and girls. And the conclusions and the narratives about most of these wars were that women and girls bore the greatest brunt. But they go on and say, well, the abuse of women in these uncivil wars led to the emergence of a movement that we doubt was ever imagined by perpetrators of violence against women, the women's peace movement. As the carnage increased on the bodies of women, they were compelled to start their own revolution, a revolution that would see men give up their weapons and give in to the pressure from nonviolent women. The narratives of war still have women as victims bearing the greatest brunt, women as refugees, sex slaves, victims of increased domestic violence, and grieving widows or mothers. However, recent actions by women have compelled the narratives to be rewritten and to take into consideration an inarguable fact that these women are also one of the primary hopes for peace in their various communities. And I think what's very hopeful at this time is that with the support and persistent encouragement of women and their allies, the international community is starting to awaken to this and starting to pay more attention. So in 2000, we saw the landmark UN resolution 1325 on women, peace, and security, which reaffirmed the importance of the role in women in the prevention and resolution of conflicts, peace negotiations, peace processes, and implementation of those processes. A recent report, the Global Study on Resolution, that some of you have been involved in generating, which is a 400-page report, speaks to the value of that. It's one of the most comprehensive and updated compilations of the growing evidence that women's empowerment contributes to the success of peace talks and the achievement of sustainable peace. It accelerates economic recovery, strengthens our peace operations, improves our humanitarian assistance, and can help counter violent extremism. But there is a gap. There is a gap between the robustness of this normative framework and the weakness of implementation on the ground. And the report speaks directly to this, and talking about the lack of political will, the lack of accountability and resources behind this, and the existence of ongoing institutional and attitudinal barriers about the involvement of women. In the last 15 years, there have been a long list of recommendations, but few sticks and carrots to induce compliance. And the global study, which I recommend that you download, suggests new ideas for these in a number of ways. I also want to say that today, I believe, is the last day of the Commission on the Status of Women meeting, which has been at the UN for the last couple of weeks. This is the 60th session of the CSW, which is the principal global intergovernmental body exclusively dedicated to the promotion of gender equality and empowerment of women. So that's the good news. In this context of this movement, this energy, this hope, that tonight we bring you the 2016 Sustaining Peace Conference and tonight's keynote talk and panel discussion on a new vision of women, peace, and security. So if I can, I'd like to introduce my colleague and friend, Leymah Gbowee, who I've now known for, I don't know, probably 10 years or so. Leymah is an extraordinary, provocative, fascinating individual. You know where she's been. People know her well. She is the 2011 Nobel Peace Prize laureate. She is a Liberian peace activist, she's a mother of six first, right? Yes. This just in, a mother of seven. this says ranging in ages from 4 to 21, but yes, okay. And an extraordinary peace activist, a trained social worker, and a women's rights advocate. She is a founder and current president of the Gbowee Peace Foundation Africa. She also founded the Liberian Reconciliation Initiative and co-founder and former executive director of the Women, Peace, and Security Network Africa. She's also a founding member and former Liberia coordinator of Women and Peacebuilding Network and the West Africa Network for Peacebuilding. She currently serves as a member of many high-level task force for the International Conference on Development. She's a board member of the Federation of Liberian Youth. her leadership of the Women in Liberia Mass Action for Peace, which brought together Christian and Muslim women in a nonviolent movement, which I imagine she will speak to today a bit, played a pivotal role in ending Liberia's civil war in 2003. And her work in that time is chronicled in two volumes. One is her memoir, Mighty Be Our Powers, which I would strongly recommend. And the other is in the documentary, Pray the Devil Back to Hell, which is an extraordinary film that won the Tribeca Film Festival Documentary Award, Best Documentary Award a few years back, and does document Leymah's story and the story of her colleagues and the women in Liberia, and the critical importance of that woman, of that movement for Liberia, but for women's work on peace around the world. So with that, I will ask you to welcome Leymah Gbowee.
Thank you so much, Peter, and thank you to the AC4 staff and Earth Institute for pulling this together. Poor Josh, trying to get me nailed down and getting my dates in New York and getting me to answer to emails, and to all of you just for really trying to bring this together, I want to say thank you. I'm really grateful to God tonight being here. I also like to recognize a few individuals in the room, Jen Jenner. Jen met me like a gazillion years ago when no one knew me, a traumatized young lady just surviving war. And I think she asked me, she tell the story of asking me, how are you? And 3 hours later, I was still talking about my experience of surviving the war. I have my wonderful niece slash daughter, Limo Madison, here with me. So when you talk about children, I technically lay claim to 9. My niece is like the first child. First, my brother is like the first child. My father had a son outside of my mother's thing with him, thing. And then Limu is my sister who took care of all of my children and made my work possible, but she passed a few years ago. So Limu is her only child, so that's my child now. And then 5 biological children, 2 adopted. The newest adopted one is 4. We adopted him like 7 months ago. There's this new wave of religion in Africa where people would place their misfortunes on children. And this little boy last year was thrown out of the only home he knew because they said he was a witch. So at 11:30 p.m., we went to pick him up, and he has become one of our own now. So so everyone, my kids are afraid when people tell stories of children because they're like, are you bringing one more home? I have an 18-year-old who said, this is no fun. I've counted, and all of my limbs, my fingers and my toes, I've counted siblings on them. Mama, please, I don't want to use my head to count my siblings. So, but that's the number of children that I have. I want to say thank you because this is a theme that is very close to my heart. The whole theme of women, peace, and security, and the vision of women building peace and being a part of the world. I grew up in a tiny community in Liberia where it was kind of like the place where children were psychologically damaged in a good way. We had Christians and Muslims living in that community, and you never knew who you were because we celebrated Ramadan, we celebrated Christmas, Easter, everyone wore dresses, and it was fun. When the lights went out, we came into the middle of the community and we danced, and the adults were there to applaud us. I tell the story of December was the time that the school year would end in Liberia. And around the 15th and the 17th was when we were giving your report card, just before Christmas, really cruel. And once you receive your report card, you had to go from one house to the other, regardless of who that person was. And you would go and kneel down and say, Uncle, I pass. And you got a coin. Those of them who failed would go very quietly to those homes and say, and then you're trying to give it and go far because trust me, you're getting a smack on your head. So imagine going to 20 homes and being chastised. And the way I put it was, as children, we're celebrated when there was a reason to celebrate, and we're disciplined when there was a reason. So I grew up with that sense of community, the sense of everyone's problem is your problem. And then the war came. The war came and turned that world upside down. Immediately, we were being told, you can't interact with this group, you can't interact with that group because of different reasons. And I remember being a very angry person, very, very angry. I was so angry. Why is this life so hypocritical? And that anger took me a very long way. And then some turns in my life, I was forced to interact with ex-child soldiers. And those were the group of people that I hated the most. I remember my first interaction with them, I walking into a room and they insulting me for 1 hour. And I stood there for 1 hour and took it. Because within my mind, I kept saying to myself, my life is tied to these losers. And because the requirement for me to go back to college was that I had to practice social work with some group. And that was the only job that was available. And the next day I went back, they cost me for 59 minutes. And the following day, 58 and 57, and finally they asked me, won't you go away? And I'm like, I'm never going away, so let's just get used to each other. But something in me that had been planted from my socialization began to bloom as I interacted with these young people, the seed of peace that had been planted. And that seed led me, and the anger led me to wanting to really discover why first did we go to this place as a civilized nation, Liberia? 3 million people, we kill almost 10% of our population, 1 million internally displaced, 500,000 refugee. The damage, infrastructure damage on that nation is still there today. I remember the first time we took these kids to Ghana as refugees. My boys went to play soccer and went back into my cousin's house and went straight to stand in the fridge because that was their first time seeing a fridge and it was the place they thought they could cool their bodies. Children and my son at the time would flush the commode because it was so fascinating to him. Switching on and turning off the light was something like a game for them. Till today, some young children who live in that country have no clue that you can plug an electric iron in the wall and press. All they know is that the iron sits on a fire and you use it to press your clothes. So this is a nation that went down, and the economic said it was a place, a failed state, where neighbors were eating each other's dogs and they were fighting for snails. So Liberia went down to the worst. And every time we saw this and the different things that happened, I would get so angry. And at one point in time, I remember going to Ghana and there was this interaction of West African remains. So if you look at the 90s, that was the period of intense conflict in West Africa. Everywhere was embroiled in conflict. Even those countries who were not involved in overt conflict was in a state of conflict because we're so close as West Africans. Nigerians were peacekeepers in Liberia, Guineans. So the whole sub-region was just in total turmoil. So we got to this meeting in Ghana, a group of us women, were about 20 of us, and they said we're going to talk about women in peacebuilding. I had been volunteering and working with the trauma healing program of the Lutheran Church of Liberia. And I recognized that at that time, that was not a phrase that was known in West Africa. No one was thinking about women in peacebuilding. I would go to these different meetings and I would do some trainings, but even me, none of the participants of the training respected me because they assumed that I was there either to cook or as a logistician, not as a trainer. And so when we got to Ghana, we're talking about all of the problems that we had in West Africa and how women could create a space to start being active peace builders. For me personally, it struck a chord because the program I worked with at the time, beyond the ex-combatants, was working with security sector. And we would go to meetings with the security men to do trauma healing with them. And there would be maybe 50 participants in the room and two women. And the entire time, none of those women would speak for 5 days in that room. But after the session, they would come and engage me as the only woman on my training team to talk about that particular aspect of the training I can relate to, I want to talk about. And so why didn't you speak in the room? It's, no. It's not supposed to be that way. Because also they were the lowest ranking officers in the room. So after we came back with the Women Peace Building program, I decided, gather some women, let's start the Women Peace Building Network Liberia. Little did we know that first it would lead me to where I find myself, Colombia. If anyone had told me in 2016 I'll be standing here, I'll tell them, stop kidding me, let alone getting a Nobel Peace Prize. But we just threw ourselves into this work, not because we wanted to prove something, but because it was the reality of the life that we live. So one of the days after we started first with the Christian women, we did the Muslim women and brought the whole group together. And in bringing this group together, we wanted to see, I had a tiny bit of peace building experience from the few workshops that I had gone to. So one day we just said to them, let's have your vision for peace. And in that group, there were the ones who were very educated, and there were the ones who had little or no education. In my head, like people in all of the international community today, I already knew who would give me the best vision for peace. And those were, in my mind, the educated women. So everyone was supposed to go home and write a vision for peace for Liberia from their perspective. The next day, they brought this vision back. And the first person to hand me their vision was a young woman called Grace. Grace, at the time, was a foot soldier. That's how we describe her in the movement. Her job was just to take letters from office to office. She had not completed high school, so we didn't see any intellectual ability. She was virtually homeless, had nothing. As I stand here, I can still imagine her. Her white was very dull because we used to wear white. And she would wear these brown sandals and her leg would be so dusty because if we gave her $10 for transportation, she pocketed it because she didn't know where her next meal would come from and walked away. So she came anxiously the next day and said, boss, I have my vision. And I looked at her and said, oh, let me have it. Good thing was we had asked another group to look at it for us. And after they did the vetting, Grace's vision was the vision that we were supposed to use nationally. I could not believe it. But what she had done was she had taken her life experience and all of the pains that she's gone through as a result of the war and put it in that document. She could barely write. So she had someone sit, she wrote what she could, and then had someone sit with her to read it and make it, whether it sounded good. And she said, that was not what I was spelling. I wanted to spell this. And they helped her edit her paper, and she brought it back. Just last year, we were doing a training for young people in Monrovia, and she brought a copy of the vision and said, do you remember this? And I was all tears again. Because this is someone who understood. But after giving that vision, we took the vision and said, we must make at least part of this vision a reality. And that led to
or stepping out in one of the most militarized societies and said we were going to build peace. And we did it in such a way that when I look back again, there are so many myths and misconceptions, especially in academic space about grassroots activism. So we started by protesting. And then every day we'll go out there and protest. And so what do you imagine? A group of barely educated women coming from protesting, the next thing is to go home, right? Because they have to cook for their husbands. No. The next thing was to go back to where we gather every day and sit down. And this is how we did evaluation. What did we do right today? Okay, so we're in a room of all university people. Peter, is that evaluation? What did we do right today? What did we do wrong today? How can we improve tomorrow? So every day we did that. And every day we tweak our strategies and our tactics to fit something. So today we went to this place, we met with this minister of government, but some of the women were not serious. So how do we do something tomorrow to capture their imagination or to draw attention to this work that we're doing? So for 2.5 years, every day we went to protest, every day. And one of the things that we would do is to sit in there until everyone got it. So sometimes from 5 in the evening till 10 at night. So eventually the husbands, women who had husbands, would come and stand outside and wait to escort us home because it was not safe for us. We did this work until peace came. When the peace came, but before the peace came, there was this whole process of designing the peace agreement. And when we went to the architects of the peace agreement, some notable institutions and organizations, including the UN and the US government, they said, there is no way we can use you all. You are not part of. You cannot be. And you don't have the educational, you don't have the political connection, you don't have this, you don't have that, and you do have the other. But we decided we would still send them every day rating documents about how we thought the peace agreement would go. We asked them when the peace agreement was finally drafted to give a benchmark on its implementation. They said no. We took it into our hands. Gather some of the women who were lawyers and who could read and understand some of the jargons in the thing, help us to simplify it to the level of the women that we work with. And once we had done that, we called 80 women leaders and said 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 is what is supposed to happen in this country for the next 1 year. If you don't see it happening, protest. And so these women decided we continue to do this work. When it was time for elections, we got out there again, and we were doubted. I'm telling you all of this to tell you that it's not just a Liberian phenomenon. Women, peace, and security, and the work of ordinary women in trying to fast-track peace in their communities is so overlooked, even with all of the resolutions and the international protocols we have in place. Last year, we call it the year of our commemorative year for women, peace, and security. Last year was 100 years when the women went to The Hague. Bertha von Suttner, Susan B. Anthony, all of the great women. And that's where they started the Women League for Peace and Freedom. Last year was 20 years since the Beijing Platform for Action. Last year was 15 years for the UN Security Council Resolution 1325, and Peter talked about the 400-page global study that came out. I was on the advisory committee that helped to shape the study. With all of these milestone events, you would think that we are at a place in our world today where there's a recognition of the increasing role of women in the peace and security sector. You're in for a shock. Over the last few years, we've seen different things happen in different places. Today, in our world, this world that we live in, there are 692 militia and guerrilla groups across the world. 66 nations are at war with itself or its neighbors. In many parts of the world, places where conflict we thought had ended, they're re-emerging. I am 44 years old, and I look forward to the day where I will see Israel and Palestine, the conflict there, come to an end. In Syria alone, there are 97 militia groups operating. In South Sudan, 1 year ago, there were 16 militia groups. That number have doubled to 26 militia groups. DR Congo has 37. And we can go on. In the Middle East, the Middle East has 8 countries at war. But there are 229 militia and guerrilla groups. Whereas Africa has 28 countries in conflict, and there are 203 militia and guerrilla groups. So again, like Peter said, there is this changing dynamics. When the South Sudanese war started in 2013, there were only two militia groups or warring groups, the government and the opposition group. From 2013 till today, we have 226. Almost every home that has an AK-47 is a militia group. And so the peace table is widening, not to bring peace, but it's widening for the selfish interest of people who own guns. The question we want to ask ourselves, so how do we end this? And where are the women in all of this? Because the women globally have been tested and proven that they can build peace. But what we see happening, especially after the launch of the global study last year, I gave a very sanitized speech sitting at the UN, Ban Ki-moon, Fumzela, the one who authored the study. I'm looking for the UN women staff that is here. We were sitting there, and after I gave my speech, the African women in the room said to me, "Leymah, that was not you. You were too diplomatic, but there was so much cynicism underneath everything that you said. Or that we just do not understand." I said, "Well, how do you expect me to say anything else? This is the one space in the world where we come and we think that something good will happen." So at the end of the launch of the global study, what we learned was that the women, peace, and security agenda had been tied to the counterterrorism agenda. So today you have groups like USAID and others who will put money into ending violent extremism and not community peace building. What you're seeing is a recognition of what women can do, but let's roll it back a bit and bring in the military track. So we sat in that room at the end of the launch of the study, and one after the other, we saw countries pledge 5 million, 50 million to the counterterrorism agenda and 200,000 to the women, peace, and security agenda. And I was sitting there and asking myself, when you spend peanuts on peace, what do you expect the world to turn into? Let's take a step back and look at this country, even as we look at peace and security for women. Since 2001, when the bombings took place, the Twin Tower, America has moved, unfortunately, from the welcoming place and gradually to the place of extremism. And someone will say, "No, it's not that way." Oh, yes, it's that way. And you feel it and see it when you're dressed like me and pass through the airports. You feel it and see it when you're dressed like someone with a turban and pass through the airports. And the question we want to ask ourselves, even as we try to vision, have a new vision for women, peace, and security, when have we ever, and this is basic 101 conflict resolution, when have you ever extinguished a fire by using fire? It never happens. And if anyone says that's what the New York Fire Department is using, I want to see them fight a fire any day. But the response, the global response, not just to the 629 militia groups or to the 66 countries that are at war, is let's militarize communities more, let's militarize societies more, and let's kick out the people who are doing the actual work. Women have been tried and they've been tested, and it's no, we don't need to make any cases, any more case that when it's peace and security, they're able to unroll it into communities. Not with guns. We live it, we saw it, and at the end of the day, we're able to unroll peace in Liberia. I'll tell you all a quick story. We went to see President Taylor. And Liberia at the time, there was a ban on protests and gatherings. There was a ban on different things. And so after we were out in the street for so long, we said we're going to meet with the president. We sent 7 different or 10 different letters to his office because he could not deny he did not receive any through his wife, through his pastor, through his brother, through his secretary. We just gave to anybody who we thought would reach him. On that day that we were going to meet with President Taylor, the security said to us, you can't come in if you're less than 25. Because the country was so militarized that no one believed that women would step out on that day to meet with him. And so I asked if we're more than 25, and he went, then you can come. I said, if we're more than 100, and he looked at me like, are you serious? I doubt if you'll be that number. So I whip out my cell phone, call the women, and said, line up and come down. There were 2,500 of us. And as the sea of whites came down, all he could say was, oh my God, these women are really serious. One of the fighters pulled me on the side. He was in plain clothes, and they were about to take him to prison because he had refused to shoot one more bullet in that war. And he said to me, Ma, if I die, no problem. But you all cannot stop this work. We are tired. And from place to place that I've traveled and seen women do the work that they do in terms of the peace and security work that they do, you never hear we are exhausted. In DR Congo, after going through numerous rape, they still reconsolidate and they're ready to step out to do good by their communities. I find myself working with a group of Syrians. We go to a very quiet location and try to put stuff together. And it is amazing to see how much these people, women and some men, have gone through, but just their commitment to the peace and security agenda. And then you ask yourself, so where do we go from here? Because 100 years ago, when the women went to The Hague, they visioned a different world, a world of peace, a world of ending conflict. When the Beijing Platform for Action was penned, people vision equality for women, leading to peace and security for them. The UN Security Council resolution was a milestone resolution that came into existence because of civil society activism. 15 years later, We're still making cases for women in peacekeeping operations. We're still making cases for women at the peace table. We're still making cases for different things. And then you ask yourself, so what is this new vision? And I honestly do not think it's a new vision. I think the vision is already there. But the question is, how do we unroll this vision to the world? I think the first thing that we can do, or we must do, is to begin to get women to participate. Not in a token manner, but in a proactive manner. The question I asked some of the officials of South Sudan, what will it take to get women at the table as active participants? Guns and a lot of stupidity spewing out of their mouths? Because when you see the men sitting around the table, that's all you get. Half-educated men with guns and egos as big as the room that they're sitting in, and they have no vision for where they want to take their countries. And we're beginning to see some politicians like that in some great countries in the world. The second thing you want to see happen is funding. This last week was crazy for me because I was at the UN and we were doing all kinds of things and we're celebrating the Human Rights Council 10th anniversary and all of those things. And one of the things that I realized as we were there, there was all this conversation about the closing democratic space for civil societies to operate, which is true. It's very difficult to operate in many countries. People here, but India, because of the Ford Foundation problems, but it's everywhere. And it's primarily because a lot of the international institutions have these mandates and policies that should tie civil society organizations to working effectively with governments. That is not going to work. In my own country, if I have to tap into money from UN Women by being friends with my Ministry of Women and Children's Affairs, my organization will die. Because I refuse to take a stand against human rights and justice, against corruption and all of the different practices. And once you speak out, you become enemy of the state. And if you are going for funding, and if that funding is tied to government approving you for some bilateral organization, whatever organization to give you money, you are not getting it. So the whole agenda of unrolling the vision to make it a reality needs not just participation, but serious funding. I can't for the word of me see how people can spend $3 billion a day to buy guns. And what we've seen is that it's not working. A few years ago, we went after Saddam Hussein. Today is ISIL. And people will not change their tactics or strategy to say, maybe, just maybe, if we begin to use the nonviolent approach and use the women in communities, we can definitely come closer to peace. The third thing that can help us bring the vision of women, peace, and security to light, and the women, peace, and security is not just peace and security for women. Is building peace, sustaining peace, and creating conditions for community members to survive and to be the best that they want to be in life. Political will. And this political will is not just from governments, but it's from the UN level, the EU level, and every other entity level. We can't be speaking the language from the corners of our mouths. If we say we want to do peace and security for women, it has to be everyone standing up. A few years ago, we had a very interesting case. In the military in Liberia, when you're pregnant as a woman recruit, or first, there's a law, you can't get pregnant for 5 years. And if you get pregnant, you're dishonorably discharged. One of the girls got pregnant for one of the higher-ranking officers, and
all of the things involved, activists got involved, nothing happened, and she was discharged. So we went to meet with our president, who is the commander-in-chief and the first female president of Africa, and said, Madam Sirleaf, so-and-so thing happened. Oh my God, why didn't you all come to me to tell me this? We would have protested together and ended this. Next time it happens, come back to me. That was the end of it. For the Women, Peace, and Security vision to be a reality in the world that we live in today, people have to be prepared to be on the wrong side of powerful people. And this is happening every day, but it's happening with women in communities. They are standing on the wrong side. Last week, we were in a meeting with the South Sudanese warlord's wives. And the former leader of South Sudan, John Garang's wife, was sitting there. And the rebel leader, Riek Machar's wife, was also there. And she kept making case for her husband and why it's not possible for him to go back to Juba. We do not have a place to stay. And I was so proud of Mrs. Garang when she turned to Angelina and said to her, that house that you keep saying government burnt was not your house. It was government's house, and government decided to burn it. You, as a leader who think you have the people at heart, need to encourage your husband to come back. And the question I asked myself afterwards was, how are they going to take all of these very strong words that she's giving this woman when she tried to interact with them? But you have to, governments and international organizations must be able to say, I've been in meetings where some of the high power brokers will say, you know, this thing is happening to the women in this country, but I don't want to go public with it. But until people begin to name and shame and really take stand, this agenda, which is the hope for the world, will never come true. And I begin with telling the stories of ordinary women who had done great work to bring peace to Liberia. And not just Liberia, I see them doing it in DR Congo, in Libya, in South Sudan, even in the midst of the fiercest war. My dream is that these women will come into spaces like Colombia to influence some of the conversations, to mentor some of the young people, to see that when you come from Colombia, it's not just the UN that should be your last stop. That you can invest or you can help to change the trend of the world. My dream is that someday, like I'm standing here, some of the women who are barely literate, like Grace Walsh, can come here and share their vision for peace, can share their vision for peace and security, but can also share some of their practical knowledge about what they've done in communities to make their communities safe. And it is my hope, and I hope, and I know that it's going to come to reality, that this is something that we can do. To that effect, the AC4 and the Earth Institute and myself have been working, Josh and Jan and Beth, into trying to put a program together on women, peace, and security to come to this place. Something that would bring practical experience to the academic space, pairing them. I'll give an example. When I went to do my graduate studies, it was after we had protested in Liberia. But there was always a doubt about the work that I had done in Liberia. Is this something that is really peace building? And then I went to school, EMU, beautiful place. And then one day the teacher says strategy. And this is a strategy. I did that. Tactics in peace building, I did that. And after a while, I was like, why am I here? But the answer was simple. I needed that validation to be taken seriously. And I think women everywhere have their vision. The South Sudanese women have vision for peace. The Syrian young girls, I did something with them when we were doing our hideout work and say, envisage the Syria after the war.
And these young people had plans. And the way they did it, after we did this work, was there was a painter, an artist in the room who had not touched his brush since the war started in Syria and he got raped. And when these girls were visioning, they encouraged him and he picked up a brush and started painting the new Syria. Just from the vision and the songs that these girls were singing. And I hope and pray that we're able to come to that place. Because you see, peace building and advocacy for peace and security, especially the work that women do, is not something that is one track. It is tied to the livelihood of communities and society. I know that once we were able to bring our vision to pass in Liberia with peace, democracy was possible, security sector reform was possible, children were able to go back to school, hospitals were working again, and people were able to begin to dream of a life after war. And this can only happen if those who know everything about the conflict, women, those who are there when the first bullet is fired, women, those who are sustaining society in the midst of the carnage, women, and those who are protesting even in the midst of the carnage, women, and the ones who bear the brunt of the war, women, are involved in the process. I will close with this. The way peace is done in the world today, and the way the peace and security agenda is unrolled in the world today, it's like trying to see with your one eye covered. Leaving women out of the bigger picture is just covering this eye and trying to see this whole room very well. You can never get the whole picture. And I think for us to have a peaceful world, we need to begin to see with two eyes open. And seeing with two eyes open is the vision for the Women, Peace, and Security agenda. It's the vision for a peaceful world. It's the vision for a democratic world. Thank you.
So thank you, Leymah, for those words from the heart. I think every time I've heard you speak, it's always from the heart, unfiltered. I think that was unfiltered. All right, so my name is Beth Fisher Yoshida, and I'm co-executive director of AC4, and I direct the master's program on negotiation and conflict resolution. For tonight, what I'd like to do is moderate the panel here. I'm going to introduce our two other speakers. They'll have about 10 minutes each to share their thoughts, and then we'll have the panel maybe respond to each other's comments, and then we'll open it up to the audience for questions and comments. Okay? All right. So first, I'm going to introduce Dr. Anu Anandaraja. She's a pediatric physician and faculty of Mount Sinai Master's in Public Health Program and assistant professor of pediatrics and medical education at the Icahn School of Medicine, also at Mount Sinai. She's designed and managed field programs to train medical students and physicians for work in underserved regions of the world. She's very passionate about women's and girls' empowerment, and so now we'll turn to Anu, Dr. Anu, to speak for about 10 minutes.
Thank you. So firstly, thank you to AC4 and everyone who's been involved in organizing this event for inviting me along. It's a great honor to be on a panel with Ms. Gbowee and with Professor Naki and also with Beth, and to be speaking to a room which I'm sure is full of experts and people who have thought very deeply and written and represented globally on this topic. So what I bring, what I offer to this conversation are really my observations from the field, from being a health practitioner in the field, and thinking deeply for the last 20 years about what women's security really means in the sphere of health. As a pediatrician, I've worked in maternal and child health for around 20 years now, and worked on programs in maternal and child health across the globe in many countries. And one thing that's been obvious to me over the last 20 years when I think about women and security is that security does not exist for women anywhere. It doesn't matter whether I've been working in a so-called developed country like New Zealand or a developing country such as Mozambique. When a woman walks into my clinic, no matter which country or on which continent, there is never an assumption that she is secure, that there is security for her. She always carries with her the knowledge or the suspicion or the threat of physical harm, of psychological harm. Her integrity of her body is always questioned, is always up for grabs. When I think about security as a doctor, it really does start with the integrity of the body, of a woman's physical being. It's about the being that inhabits this body being able to decide for it, make decisions for its well-being. It's about the being that inhabits a body being able to access the resources and the support, the physical spaces to ensure the well-being of the body and to ensure the well-being of the children that come from that body. And if we are unable to secure this, then the battle has been lost on all fronts. So for me, this is what the practice of health on a global health level should be promoting and building towards, is the increased security of women's bodies. And the problem is, as Ms. Gbowee has laid out tonight, that we're faced with a global culture in which violence against women is pervasive. And we must become more and more astute at seeing it, more committed to calling it out, and more skilled at transforming it through our practice. So on my learning curve as a pediatrician in the global health community, there are many ways in which I've observed health programming has been able to contribute towards women's security, but there are also many ways in which we could and we should be doing better, and we need to envision a new stage in our evolution. So in the past, we've often sought to improve conditions for women by focusing on their protection. Protection of women from a violent and an unjust society. And we protected initially by segregating, by creating separate facilities, separate programs, separate service entry points for women and children. But while creating access and privacy for women, this has also had some unintended consequences. So in our attempts to prioritize and to elevate the health needs of women, we've created siloed programmatic areas to deal with women's health. We've named them maternal and child health, maternal, child and newborn health, reproductive health. And so we've designed and we've funded and we've implemented and delivered based on these programmatic areas. And while they may have increased access, they've also made reproduction the center of the female health paradigm. So in how we've articulated our health goals for women through the MDGs, the SDGs, our programmatic allocations on every level, we locate women's existence and their value firmly within their childbearing role. So yes, the biological and the social vulnerabilities that go with pregnancy and childbirth, they're real. They deserve to be addressed. But this is an overarching approach to the health of women, reinforces that a woman's value and identity comes primarily from her reproductive capability, so from her ability to generate the next generation. So we have to ask ourselves at this point, what risks does this dominant assignment as child bearer and honor bearer and mother of a nation expose a woman to in times of conflict where rape is carried out to desecrate another man's property, to shame a society, to cleanse it of an ethnic group? And also in everyday existence, what pressures and influences does this assumed motherhood immediately place on a girl's opportunities? How does it restrict her abilities, her own perception of herself, that she's ultimately seen by her family and her community as reaching her greatest and her ultimate potential, and also her right to health care only once she comes into the realm of motherhood? And how does the emphasis on the reproductive capabilities of women devalue and isolate older women? So these are questions not just for the Global South, obviously, but for women in societies all over the globe. The other thing that I've learned from years of programming is that we create problems, we create indirect consequences that are harmful for women when we alienate men from health services and healthcare delivery systems. So this gender segregation, the care models that have gender segregated were created to deliver care to mothers and children and were motivated by good intentions and the need to ensure privacy and access for those groups. But they also have isolated men from participation and responsibility in the healthcare and well-being of their families. Healthcare models, clinic models that are focused on women and children as the family unit to the exclusion of men, they create a scenario in which women will continue to have to bear sole responsibility for the care of infants and children and sole responsibility for things such as contraception and managing the transmission of sexually transmitted infections, One example of this is, you know, some of the clinic systems that we manage in Mozambique. We've worked very hard to make them safe places for women and children to come to. So we've created separate systems where we've had great success in channeling women and children from the community through these clinic systems, and we know everything there is to know right now that we can find out about rates of HIV transmission among pregnant women. However, in creating those systems, we've effectively isolated men from accessing HIV testing. And you don't need me to tell you that if we're not dealing with HIV in men, we're not dealing with HIV in women. Women are involved in the care of their boy children from the moment they're born through the life cycle. But men in many cases are completely isolated and exempt from the responsibility for care and nurturance of their daughters. They're isolated from the joy of providing care and nurturance for their daughters and from the ability and the opportunity to emotionally bond and to form empathy for their girl children. So how can we expect that this can do anything but reinforce a lack of value for females in society and in families? So my thesis is that as in the next step of our global health evolution, our evolution as human beings, we cannot continue to focus on protection through segregation as our strategy. Effectively protecting women from a violent society is not the end game, and it cannot be. The end game is transformation of our society into one that is not violent towards women, not violent, full stop. And integration will have to play an essential role in this. We have to aspire again, I feel, towards a state of cooperation and inclusion that many of us have given up on. So a vision for moving together that guides the design and implementation of social programs across networks is needed. So for me in the health landscape, when we talk about everyday peace builders, these are people who leverage health services to do just this, to transform a culture towards less violence, less stereotyping of gender roles, and greater partnership. So I'm just going to leave you with one example. In rural India, an organization called the Comprehensive Rural Health Project has been delivering rural health care for over 4 decades. They've been recognized as a model for close to community care across the world and across India. And in the 1970s, in order to improve health access in remote villages, they began to train community health workers. So this is not a unique model, but what CRHP did, their transformative move was in who they chose. They chose women, and not just any woman, they chose illiterate women, women from the lowest caste, untouchable caste, from within the Indian villages. So at first, of course, these village health workers, they were trained, they were equipped to diagnose and manage the things that were creating illness and death in their villages, pneumonia, diarrhea, malaria. But in the beginning, they were shunned by their neighbors. No one wanted to invite an untouchable woman into their home. and they were shunned by their families. Men were ashamed of their wives seeking employment outside of the four walls of their home. But over time, the women persisted. They had begun to love their new trade. They'd begun to love to learn and to feel that they had something to offer to their communities, and they were skilled. And they persisted in offering their services. So over time, their husbands and the communities began to see results. They noticed that the families that were actually availing themselves of the village health workers' services had healthier children. Their kids were better nourished. They had lower rates of diarrhea and malaria in their households. Gradually, the upper caste families started to take on the service of the VHWs when nothing else was available, when babies were born in the middle of the night and they were having difficulty breathing, when a child had a fever that wouldn't come down, and they began to see results. Over time, the whole community saw that the villages, the areas that actually availed themselves of the services of the village health workers had lower rates of malaria, of diarrhea, of tuberculosis. It was just a lived experience of something working. Across the communities, women's access to health care increased. Care was coming straight into their homes in the form of other women. Men were included in the health care of the family because the care was taking place under their roofs. So instead of hanging out in the doorways of the homes, kind of listening with half an ear to what was going on, men started to come in and sit beside their wives as health education was delivered, to hear the messages about how important it was to feed your girl child as much as your boy child, to send your girl to school, like the dangers of dowry and early marriage and early pregnancy. And men and boys were in the room when the discussions around contraception, family planning, sexually transmitted infections were actually happening. So over years, changes occurred in the village, definitely on a health outcomes level, but the changes went far beyond health outcomes. The village structure was gradually reorganized. The homes of untouchable families began to be integrated, no longer on the outskirts of the village. People of different castes were mixing. More and more women were trained to be health workers. They were getting jobs outside of the home. More girls were being sent to school. There was less female infanticide. And the VHWs went on to assess what else their communities needed and responded by setting up adolescent girls groups and vocational training for their youth. The communities themselves had become more tightly knit, more cohesive, more resilient, and much less likely to fracture along lines of caste or religion when things started to get tough. And those strong community networks, they had at their core strong female leadership. So this process itself was not high tech, it wasn't resource intensive. It involved transferring capabilities and a small amount of resources to local women, involving men, and then supporting that community to set and follow goals that were based on their own observations, their own needs, their own priorities. They had the flexibility to respond to a local context and to be creative in ways that external funding agendas, Gantt charts, USAID work plans don't often allow. So to be sure, the CRHP story unfolded over decades. This wasn't a three-year funding cycle. There were multitudes of setbacks, there were difficulties, there were failures along the way, but success stories like this, as Leymah has told us, that start with community-level action led by women, are widespread. So the work of documenting these models, identifying the common elements that are transportable, and then sharing these as best practices is essential work. But documenting what already exists is not the ultimate step. Reimagining is the next step. What would it look like if we actually developed healthcare models that focus on integration and togetherness and inclusion, on promoting cooperation and understanding across lines of gender? Models that place a whole family unit at the center of healthcare, that promote a father's involvement and emotional attachment to his family, and that uncouple a woman's status and value from her reproductive capabilities. It's that kind of reimagining that could change a paradigm and change the world. So for me, creating learning experiences through which people have the opportunity to reimagine is powerful and important work. And for the last 10 years through Mount Sinai, we've brought medical students and doctors into the field for exactly that purpose. But it takes more than medical professionals. So the work that Leymah in Colombia, AC4, are now embarking upon is transformative. It's enabling us to learn from those who are hard at work every single day, reimagining, shifting the paradigm, interacting with people like Leymah and women around the globe who are everyday peace builders allows us to understand the courage and the wisdom and the vulnerability and the joy and the success and the disappointment of those that live and work every day for peace. And it inspires us to commit our own lives to reimagining and building a more peaceful world. So thank you.
Thank you, Anu, for a very moving speech. I'd like now to introduce Sarah Nucky. She's the Leif, Cabraser, Hyman, and Bernstein Associate Clinical Professor of Human Rights at Columbia Law School and co-director of the Human Rights Clinic. She's an international human rights lawyer working on issues such as unlawful killings, armed conflict, sexual violence, extractive industries, and more. She has many publications. She's also an advisor to the UN on different issues. Sarah?
Thank you. Thanks, everyone, to coming, and thanks to the organizers. And thanks, Leymah, especially for your vision. I came back a couple of days ago from the Central African Republic. I was there with some of our law students working with women's human rights advocates who, of course, were provided very little funding or support from the international community. But when we were there, we met with a large group of mid-20s, university-age Muslim students in Bangui, men and women who told us that they haven't been able to go to university since the crisis started 3 years ago. They were studying theology, business administration, law, human rights, and they hadn't been able to enter a class since the crisis started because of discrimination and because of insecurity for them. So I'm feeling especially grateful this week to be able to be at this university and to be at this event, and I hope that the vision that you outlined at the end, that we might be able to bring some of these people here to join in the program that you discussed. We see in conflicts all around the world women playing essential roles for peace building, reconciliation, advancing rights, and yet often excluded from senior leadership positions or their efforts not acknowledged in the ways that they should be. The kind of vision that you outlined, I think, is critically important to begin to address some of the very obvious gaps we see in many different sectors. I'd like to pick up on these issues and reflect on them in a slightly different context, but one that I think would also benefit from the vision that Leymah outlined. In Papua New Guinea, Canadian mining company's security guards over many years sexually assaulted, gang-raped more than 100 indigenous women who lived inside and around the mine site. It's not an armed conflict context, but it shares many of the characteristics. In this case, widespread violence carried out with complete impunity, and where the rape was used as a tool against the women and to achieve the goals of the security guards. The mine had been built on indigenous lands. The people weren't moved very far from the mining area, though. They lived mostly inside the mining lease, and so they were very close to the tailings waste and very close to the construction areas, and lost most of their land that they had used for farming to mining operations. This meant that they lost their source of sustainable living, and so to enter the cash economy, women would spend hours every day in the tailings waste looking for gold, but they were at the same time technically trespassing on mine property. And so the security guards, to deter them from trespassing and stealing gold from the mine, would engage in mass gang rape of the women. They would often say to them when they caught them, "You can choose jail or rape." And the women would say jail, and they would often get raped and then thrown in jail anyway. As is common in conflict and post-conflict societies, the women faced endless barriers to attempt to be able to prevent future violations, and then to achieve remedy for the violations that did occur. Most of them were understandably too afraid to report the violations to the police, since it was security forces who were abusive in the first place. They were afraid even to share the information with others in their families because of fear of retribution from male family members. But women did begin to report their cases to each other and to civil society groups working in the area. They risked their safety to come out and to support each other and to seek accountability for what happened and measures to prevent future violations against other women. The company for many years, however, dismissed the allegations that the women were making. They considered them to be lying. They considered them illegitimate sources of information. This marked a pattern that would continue for many years subsequently of women's voices being dismissed, marginalized, ignored. And women themselves had to push back against this. After a number of years of advocacy, the company eventually, to the surprise of many, admitted that the rapes had occurred. The women said, once this had happened, that they wanted to negotiate then directly with the company to discuss remedies. But the company refused, again dismissing their voices as a legitimate source of information in the context. Instead, the company created itself what's called an operational level grievance mechanism. It's a little bit like a tribunal, but privately created, and women who were sexually assaulted could access this mechanism to receive a remedy directly from the company. The company said that this mechanism was a fulfillment of the company's obligations under human rights law to provide a remedy. And it was the first of its kind for a company to implement a mechanism for serious violations of human rights. It has a number of positive elements, but as a conflict procedure, the fault that it most had was that it never involved the women themselves in the creation, the design, or the implementation of the remedy. This meant that its legitimacy was undermined in the eyes of the women for whom it was intended, and there was a mismatch between what it aimed to do and the procedures that it employed and what women needed and women wanted. As it started to be implemented, women themselves organized and pushed back on some of the procedures and pushed for reforms to how it was implemented and the remedies that were given. Some women rejected the procedure completely and said that what they were given through the remedy mechanism was like candy to a small child. The mechanism offered women who'd been gang raped about $5,800 and some counseling. And women felt that that wasn't proportionate to having been gang raped numerous times, especially given that the company is the largest gold mining company in the world. So women said, we're not going to accept this. We're going to find ourselves international lawyers, and we want to see you in court. So the company ended up settling with them and giving them a significantly larger remedy. When news of this became known, that a small number of women who'd sought international legal assistance obtained much higher remedies, the rest of the women, about 120, who had received the $5,000 amounts, they then again organized themselves. And they held a giant protest, a peaceful protest in the middle of town, and demanded their rights and said it's not equitable that those who had access to lawyers from the US received so much more. And we who've never been to school and signed our waivers with the company because we thought we had no other options received something so much smaller. And they protested and protested until the company agreed to give them a double in the remedy that they'd originally received. Women had to demand their rights at every stage of this and often literally put their bodies as part of their demand. The principles in the Women, Peace, and Security agenda are important not just in the armed conflict context. In this area, there's now an active civil society. Women are supporting each other, teaching themselves counseling each other regularly now on the phone with Canadian journalists to discuss their rights and what happened to them. Here, where women have been treated as victims or as beneficiaries of a program or passive recipients, the efforts of a company in this case or a government, no matter how well-intentioned are more likely to fail and to not really advance rights than if women are central to the process and agents of creating remedy mechanisms for themselves. Thank you.
Okay, so now I'll just open it up to the panel if you'd like to respond to each other's comments or ask questions, and then we'll open up to the audience.
Well, just one point from Anu. She talked about how the reproductive rights or the whole process of reproduction of women is somehow tied to some of the things that happen in conflict. And I really identify with that. A few years ago, in my previous life working with child soldiers, I had the opportunity of sitting with some of them in a session and saying, but I never really tied it to the whole process of reproductive health and giving birth to children. Did you all ever rape? And they said, no. And I said, really? Yes, ma'am, we did not rape anyone. And I said, okay, let me, within myself, maybe I'm not asking this question right. Did you ever force anyone to have sex? Oh, yeah. Isn't that what women are made for? Fast forward, my 10-year-old at the time goes to school and say, today is International Women's Day. And one of the little boys says, shut up and sit down. What are women made for? Just to make babies. And when she told me that, I thought back at my past life and said, if you put a gun in this 10-year-old boy's hand, he will do the same thing that this 16-year-old did during the Liberian War. But the question now is, how are we socializing our boys, ourselves, and our society that bring them to a place of thinking women are just about sex? And in their book, Women, War, and Peace, the President Sirleaf and Elizabeth Rand did a document on women, war, and peace, and one of their conclusions was that the impact of conflict on women's lives is a reflection of the interaction during peacetime. So what the levels of rape that we see happening in Congo, Liberia, Sierra Leone is tied to the image that was projected of women during the peacetime. I just thought to flag that out to that point that you made.
Yeah, just a point to that. Thank you, Leymah. One of the things that's apparent is whatever's permissible in terms of violence and attitude towards women in their homes is what becomes permissible on the street and in the global community. And so the distance we have to go to turn that around is immense. And for us working in the US, you know, even working across at Mount Sinai, the level of enculturation into the female body being a commodity from early on, from the first sentient moments of a girl or a boy's life, are just the inputs that are constantly giving the message that this is a piece of property, they're so pervasive. What we have to do as a culture and as a people to turn that around is immense. But once we start seeing the pieces, once we start seeing where it pops up, where the articulation or where the imagery or whether the way that we build systems starts to feed into those paradigms, that's the first bit. It's like then once you see it, it starts popping. And if we could teach our children to start seeing that. And it's a long road. It is a long road. It's pervasive. It's the air that we breathe. But there has to be a start. And I feel like these are the conversations where there's a start, where there's a beginning.
I'd like to open it up to the audience. Anybody have any questions or comments? I think somebody in the back there, if you'd like to stand up, there's, Kristen with the microphone. Would you mind standing so we can see you?
Hello? Okay, I gotta speak. All right, I'll stand. Yeah, I'd like you to touch upon how what is going on with refugees. A lot of it is actually refugee jihad, because many of these people are not refugees. By the time they get to the third country, even by UN concords, they are no longer refugees if they're in a safe country. They're not registering. A lot of them are benefits tourists. And I'd like you to comment also on the issue of the sort of hands-off policy that seems to exist in the media and NGOs towards Islam and the rather routine dispossession and hostility towards women, how that custom has become has come along with these alleged refugees into Europe, and how that can be addressed, because it seems to be both silence and propaganda that is denying it's happening. And it was surprised that what happened in Cologne on New Year's Day, for example, was an abnormality, and it isn't really.
Well, first thing first, I am a survivor of war, and when it comes to issues of refugees, it's very close to my heart. Until you've been taken out of your home, and not on a vacation, but unplanned, you never really understand what it is. It's never a choice. It's a matter of survival. In 1990, I was 17 years old. My parents had worked so hard to give us some of the best education that Liberia had to offer at the time. And then we went to war. There was no way for us to survive, so we had to get on a ship, unplanned, 10 people with a mother, with nothing. We got to Ghana, and we slept outside the port for 3 days under a table. Rain came and met us there. Very hot sun came, 90 degrees, and met us there. They eventually agreed to take us to a camp. When people say alleged refugees, it's discomforting for me. You have Syrians, you have others who have survived different wars. And I like the way the media put it, refugee and migrant crisis. So you have refugees and you have migrants. And the question you need to ask yourself is, who are these migrants and what are they fleeing from? A vast majority of those who fall in the category of migrants are predominantly women who are escaping domestic issues, female genital mutilation, forced marriages, and all of the different things. You also have young men, a lot of young men, who have no sight of a future, leaving places that they live to find a better life. I go to many places, sir. I go to many places. And the one thing that I know, in your moment of comfort, it's easier to be cynical. I'm in Tripoli, Libya. After the world decided to get rid of Gaddafi, I get to Tripoli 2 years after Gaddafi is dead. And the filth in that city is like it happened the day before I got there. I sit in a room with over 100 young people, and my first question was, where do you see your life in 5 years? The room was silent, and all of these young people were looking at me, and trust me, they were educated, as if I had spoken some foreign language. And one of the young men was brave enough to raise his hand and say, you asked for 5 years? I don't even see my life 30 minutes from now.
when the options for survival are limited, people have to do something. And yes, we have the migrant crisis. And yes, we have the refugee crisis. And yes, we have all of these things happening in the world. Truth be told, who is causing this problem if not from Western countries? No one had a plan for Libya. NATO came in, bombed the hell out of that country, and left. It was Gaddafi army and the insurgents group. Today you have over 28 militia groups operating in Libya. It is a failed state. There are young people like myself, that young 17-year-old who wanted to be a doctor. And my first option for my future as a doctor was to get on a ship and go to Ghana. It could have been me on those shores of Turkey and Greece. That's the first thing. So with the migrant crisis, each and every one of us need to sit down and ask this question: what have my country contributed to this global nightmare? And not just blame these people. I told you there are three groups: the real refugees, the migrants, including women who are running from domestic issue, forced marriage, and FGM, and the young people, who a lot of them are raising their hands and saying, I'd rather get on a boat and die than to join a militia group, because that's the other option that is available to them. So, supposed migrant, whatever, the one thing we all need to begin to do now is to preach the message of peace and not militarism. Because if you count from 2001 to today, since the falling of the Twin Tower, you will see that there have been increase, and it's all because of the politics of militarism, and it needs to end. When it comes to Islam and the media shying away from it, the one thing, I'm a Christian, I love Jesus. I wake up in the morning and have to fellowship with Jesus before I do anything. But trust me, I'm not one of those Christians with my head under the sand. Just as you have Islamic fanatics, you have Christian fanatics. And what we see happening in the world today, it's a situation of people misinterpreting and exploiting holy scriptures and religion as a means of getting to their political thing. The media will always tell us the ugly things about religious fundamentalism and all of the different things, but they never tell us the true story. In Nigeria, on New Year's Eve, 1 year, some people had attacked a church because they were Christians praying. This year, last 31st night, the Muslims went in the church and worshiped with the Christians and said, if you are coming to kill, you will kill all of us. In that same December in Nairobi, right after that Garasi attacked, a group of people were traveling to their villages and they got to a group of armed men and say, separate the Christians from the Muslims. The response was, there are no Christian, no Muslim, we are one people. Let us not get carried away by the rhetorics of the media. Media has to sell their story because they have to do it. I'm not saying you don't have some bad people, but amongst all of us in this world, there are some good, some bad, and some ugly. And all we need to do is to begin to say, how can we join hands and do the truth to bring in peace together? Let me say one final thing, and I will sit down, shut up, and give my colleagues a chance to talk. What I'm saying to you, I virtually smacked a journalist in Italy when I was there, when he asked that question the wrong way. similar to that, but I won't smack you. In this country, and in many parts of the world, there are stereotypes about people on the basis of the way they look and the way they dress. And every time you act on that stereotype, you build a thin wall between you and that person. And the next time you act on that stereotype, you build a thicker wall between you and that person. And over time, when you're looking at that person, you don't see a person anymore. You see the object of your stereotype. And this is how genocides begin. Let's be very careful, not just in Liberia and Ghana and Syria and other places, even here in this country, with the kind of divisive rhetorics that we hear and see. No country is above falling. A hint to the wise.
I think we have time for one more question. Yes? Yes.
Microphone, please.
Oh, coming.
Hello. I come today representing myself and the New York Academy of the Sciences. I welcome you to my hometown, New York City. I come to you representing many voices, those of myself, my city, state, and my country, the United States of America, to extend my hand in love, peace, and friendship, bringing you blessings and joy from an organization I am happy to know, that of Women in Science, and one that I helped to found with others, Scientists Without Borders, and also from international attorney Remy Iona of Nigeria and head of the Igbo people. As a mathematician, scientist, and scholar, I can say that it's simply wonderful to greet you here today, Nobel laureate Leymah Gbowee at Columbia University's Kellogg Center. I represent an organization I found, Voices Free Africa, that is founded for recovery, rebuilding, and nation building. And we want to have a full 100-year plan, and again I restate, for recovery, rebuilding, and nation building throughout the Central African Republic, and also with the refugees that are surviving there from Chad and Niger. Welcome and hello. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Any other burning question in the room? Or are you the kind of people like to have small conversations? Yes. Okay, wait a minute. Here comes the mic. Thank you.
Hi. I was just trying to understand the problem of the gang rapes that you were describing, and if it's just specific a male problem, or does it more relate to power, and if groups of women or powerful women would engage in that kind of behavior, gang raping men or even gang raping women, are women just naturally more compassionate leaders than men are?
It's a good question. We've spent the last 10 years trying to understand why groups of men would gang rape women, and I don't think I have a good answer to it. Part of it seems to be certainly an exercise of power, of men showing off in front of each other, in this case of male bonding, prestige among men, the demonstration of strength vis-a-vis other men. But none of these seem like particularly good answers. I think the most important thing for us to try and do is think of concrete tactics to prevent this kind of abuse in the future. And when we're talking about security force abuses, there are a range of measures that can be taken, whether they're private security forces or state police or military, to prevent abuses like this and to promote accountability. But it takes will on the part of states or the part of companies to address them.
So I'd like to thank everybody. We do have a reception. I think that we've learned from all our panelists is that education and awareness is critical to moving things forward and transforming. I'd like to give another round of applause to our panel, please.